Alright, this is Nima Golbabai subbing for Soul Sounds today from 4 p.m. to 6. If you don't know, I usually do a show on Wednesdays from 4 to 5. It's called Cine Show. I talk about movies and do reviews. And today, I'll be playing some songs, mostly from movies, and doing little mini reviews for you. And we're going to start off with some songs from Star Wars, and I'll do some reviews of some of my favorite Star Wars movies. Alright, let's get into it. Oh, before then, I should say, it's a special day. It's 11-11, which is a very special, I guess, day. So I've been told, and I think it's a special day too. And it was a good opportunity for me to sub, and I hope it brings me good luck. So let's start with the songs.
We ask all our patients about abuse because it is so common and because it affects your health. If your partner physically hurts you or makes you feel worthless, you can start having health issues like headaches, depression, or pregnancy complications. If you have experienced this, I'm sorry. You don't deserve to be treated that way. For help with domestic violence, call 211 or visit 211oc.org/DV. We can overcome domestic violence.
McGruff the Crime Dog here with my nephew Scruff. Here's the address for my new free comic activity book.
Scruff McGruff, Chicago, Illinois, 60652. Scruff McGruff, Chicago, Illinois, 60652.
It shows kids what to do about guns and drugs and bullies and strangers. And it's got games and puzzles, too. Write it down now.
Scruff McGruff, Chicago, Illinois, 60652.
A public service message from this station, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Thank you.
right? Those were some pretty good songs from Star Wars that I really like. We'll start from the top and go down. But before I do that, I should say I had a little problem with my computer, so there was a bit of gap before I started the next song, but we got it working, as always. So the first one was from episode 3 of Star Wars. It's a really good song for a really good movie. It's basically a space battle scene that the movie opens up with, and it's a really, really good song. I think this movie is so good, in my opinion, although some people dislike the prequels, I think they're really good. In terms of story, I think definitely the execution could be better. However, for episode 3, I think it genuinely has a very emotional arc for the main character, Anakin, and we get a really good opening battle scene. However, I've talked about it on my main show, and of course you can look that up on Cineshow, KUCI. Just put it into YouTube. I have all my episodes there for all movie needs. Then we played a song from episode 2, Attack of the Clones. A movie I consider quite underrated that I used to not like, but I've seen it a few times, and I think it's actually, like, it's quite a good movie. It's just the direction isn't very good. Then last, a movie I haven't talked about, so I'll talk about it a bit more, is a song called Your Father Would Be Proud from Rogue One. And the music is by a guy named Michael Giacchino, so it's not a John Williams. It's not a John Williams piece, which is weird for Star Wars. This is like the only movie where, well, I think it's like one of maybe two movies that they didn't use John Williams, and it actually came out really good. No offense to John Williams, but this guy did a really, really good job. He did a good job because he like kept the spirit of the original soundtrack from the first three movies, but he sort of made it a little bit more, I guess, how should I say? He like put his own unique flair on it, and it didn't sound just like a copy. Although, they say John Williams kind of copied Gustav Holst, which is a classical composer. I'm pretty sure that Gustav Holst's The Planets. They say John Williams sort of took the classical composition and made it into like a Star Wars theme song, which is kind of true if you listen to it. But Rogue One was the only good Disney Star Wars film, in my opinion. I thought it was a really cool movie. It's basically about the construction of the Death Star, and it takes place between Episode 3 and Episode 4. It stars a very good main character, Jyn Erso, as well as like a band of side characters that are quite likable and entertaining. It has really good direction, far better than any of the sequel movies, and honestly probably maybe the best of the entire series. And yeah, I think it's a really good movie you should watch. But we're going to try to use my computer again, and if it doesn't work, just allow for a few seconds pause, and then I'll just go back to using the main station computer. But we're going to be playing some songs from, we're going to go Full Metal Jacket first, which is a 2-minute song. And then I'll do a little review, and then we'll go to the Terminator soundtrack, which is really good. All right, let's do that.
faces. I like it like that.
Come on.
Come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on.
Come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on.
Come on, let me show you where it's at.
The name of the place.
I like it like that.
They got a little place across the track. The name of the place is I like it like that. Now you take Sally and I'll take Sue, and we're gonna rock away all our blues. Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
let me show you where it's at.
The name of the place is
I like it like that.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
I wanna show you.
Come on, let me show you where it's at.
The name of the place
I like it like that.
Now the last time I was down there, I lost my shoes. They had some cat shouting the blues. The people was yelling out for more, and all they was saying was go man, go. Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
The name of the place
I like it like that.
Come on,
show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
Come on,
come on, let me show you where it's at.
The name of the place is
I like it like that.
Come on.
All right, that was I Like It Like That by Chris Kenner from the movie Full Metal Jacket by Stanley Kubrick. Surely the best director ever to live. Full Metal Jacket is a really good movie, and it's definitely up there in terms of my favorite movies. However, I would definitely put it at not the top five best of Stanley Kubrick. However, I think the first, like, half of this movie is so good, or like the first 40 minutes or something like that. It's so dark, and it's so, like, human. It's basically a story about this one soldier getting bullied by a bunch of other soldiers, and it leads him to have a mental break, and he basically kills his drill sergeant, and it's done in this really, like, horrifying slow motion sort of thing. And it's just like a really, I don't know, the problem I have with war movies is sometimes they can be a little, how should I say, they're like a little like distant. Sometimes you don't feel connected to what's going on, because I feel like the characters aren't so important as individuals, and it's more like them as a group doing an objective, and it kind of muddies down the enjoyment of the film. Not saying war movies are bad, but I just think sometimes they're not as good. And the good part about the first half of Full Metal Jacket before they go to war is you can really identify and grow close to, like, one character that's going through a really hard time, who's like this overweight character who's sort of being bullied for his weight and his, like, ineptitude at being a soldier and whatnot. And it leads him to go down this dark path, and his character sort of shifts from this likable, kind of nice character to this guy that wants revenge. And back to why war movies sometimes don't work, and why I think Full Metal Jacket isn't up there with my top Stanley Kubrick movies, is because it's not like one character going through a hard time. It's too many characters in, like, a rough situation for me to, like, love them to the point where I really would. Because in, like, a typical action movie, you would only have, like, one or two characters that you get to pay attention to. And when it's this, like, when it's an army and, like, there's a bunch of characters you have to focus on, and there's sort of an, like, a, like, kind of like a evasive enemy, and there's no clear villain, I don't know. War movies just sometimes do that to me. However, There are some fantastic war movies like Apocalypse Now, which I had a fantastic time watching. I was introduced by my best friend. And that was a really fantastic film. And it sort of... But once again, it's the end of the movie that's great that isn't really the war part. The war part itself, it's still really good, and there's some awesome scenes, like the helicopter sequence is awesome, and it's super well done. But then when it's like the general movements of the armies through the rivers and stuff, it's sort of, I don't know, it just loses its heart a little bit, because it's hard to make a war movie consistently entertaining and consistently, compelling for the reasons talked about before. You don't get close to one character, really. It's harder because they're all going through a similar situation, which is difficult. And then you can't make it nonstop action with a war movie, because maybe it gets unrealistic, I guess. But some action movies, you can do that. Like, for instance, like Aliens, the nonstop action, and it made sense because it wasn't in our frame of reference, and it was like a different war situation, and it was more entertaining. But Apocalypse Now has a fantastic ending, and it's a really, really fantastically directed film. It's 3 hours, which, you know, that just cuts out 90% of the people willing to watch it. But yeah, give it a try. But now going on to some songs from Terminator, one of my favorite movies of all time, also introduced to me by my best friend years ago. And songs are really, really good in this movie. So we're going to start with my favorite one. It's called I'll Be Back. And then Reese Dreams of Future War. And then the Terminator main soundtrack. Let's go.
New music.
Thank you.
All right, so that was three songs from Terminator 1. And what a great movie Terminator 1 was. My first experience with the Terminator movies was through the awful Terminator Genesis, which is, I think it was the second most recent sequel they put out. A truly awful film with terrible acting, terrible story, terrible direction, everything awful. But the first Terminator film was all the stuff Genesis was not. It was amazing, it was original, it was done on a low budget by a, you know, a director who had never really made a film before. It's a fun story about that, actually. The director of Terminator 1, James Cameron, who also made Aliens and Titanic and other films you'll be familiar with, Avatar, he basically went from being a garbage truck driver to a film director really quickly. His first film, technically, was, I think it was called, like, Piranha 2 or something like that. Let me just search it up here. Piranha 2. I think that was his first film. Yeah, so he was first on this, like, low-budget, crappy horror film, but he actually got fired from doing it. So while it says he's the director, he really isn't. And then he went to work on Terminator, which he had a low budget, and he was sort of going off just passion at this point. And he made a total hit, and his life changed in, you know, a short period of time. This film has the honor of launching Arnold Schwarzenegger's career as a action hero. It's probably, in my opinion, the best action hero ever, I would say. It also stars Linda Hamilton as Sarah Connor and, God, what's his name? Sorry, I gotta find it out. Sorry, one second here. Oh yeah, Michael Biehn, that's his name. Michael Biehn as Kyle Reese, who plays the guy sent back into the past to try to stop the Terminator. So it's basically a time travel movie, but the great thing about it is it doesn't waste time over explaining time travel, which is like, you know, one thing I notice about, like, bad sci-fi movies is they always, like, try to over-explain the world. Or no, sorry, like, the science of the world, and it never, ever works out. So, it's best to have a simple premise and just run with it, and just get your audience to feel at home within the universe, rather than, like, using techno-babble and nonsense that nobody cares or understands. But yeah, basically this movie is really good for Halloween. I know we passed Halloween, but it's 11/11 for God's sakes. Just go watch The Terminator. It's a really fantastic movie. I love this movie so much. It's super, super good as a horror film, great as a sci-fi film, and great as a an action film. It really does amazing things on a low budget, and it's unfortunately we don't get many action films like this anymore. We don't get, like, these sort of gritty, grounded action flicks with, like, sort of powerful performances and, like, a cool premise and all that. It's never like that anymore, and real blood, because I really dislike CGI blood. I think it takes you right out of the film. But this movie is just awesome. And the sequel, Terminator 2, is less horror and more action. And that movie's also amazing. And I love those two movies. And anytime I'm feeling down, I'll always go to, like, Terminator 2, basically. and just sit back, and I just love it. I love the pure action of that film, but also Terminator 1, the horror aspect is really good. And it's not really, people don't talk about it as a horror movie a lot, but it really is. And yeah, I love it. Yeah, see, on Wikipedia it says science fiction action film, but I consider it more a horror film. That's my opinion. Alright. We're going to play a few songs from the band Ghost, and then we'll play a few songs from Batman. Batman Begins and The Dark Knight. And I'll start talking after The Dark Knight. It's going to be about 20 minutes of songs here.
We'll be right back. this is the place, man.
I'm not sure, man.
Woo! Party, party!
Can I help you, boys?
Yeah, we're here for the party, man.
We'll be right back.
Alright, that was Square Hammer and Dance Macabre from Ghost, as well as the Batman Begins theme song by Hans Zimmer, is that fella's name. Starting with Ghost, I don't know why, every time I ask people if they know Ghost, they're always like, huh? Like, they don't know what it is, and I think it's a really good band, and I don't know if it's underrated or whatever you call it, but I like them a lot. They make really nice songs. I particularly like the first one we played, Square Hammer. I think that one's really good. And their music videos are really cool, too. I recommend you go watch them. But who knows? Maybe they are famous. I just don't know why everyone I ask doesn't know. Batman Begins. Not only a great soundtrack by Hans Zimmer, but also a fantastic, and in my opinion, a movie that does not get enough love. I mean, come on, it's so good. I watched it, I think I watched it like 2 months ago, I would say, or 2.5 months ago, and I just loved it. It's such a fantastic film, and it's such a good origin story movie because it's cool to see, like, Batman, you know, getting his start more so than other movies I've seen, origin films, because, I don't know, I think Batman is just the cooler character and you want to see more of him because, you know, he doesn't really have superpowers, which is counterintuitive that it would be good for a superhero movie, because I think for superhero movies, the more relatable, the better. But that's all movies. However, you know, my dad thinks the opposite. He thinks Batman is a terrible character because he doesn't have superpowers, but I think that's total fraud. I think the more compelling character is the weaker character for superheroes. Weaker as in physical strength, not like character or whatnot, because I think Batman has the best moral character and conviction. But Batman Begins, moving on, it's got some great parts. It's got a great villain, played by Liam Neeson, Ra's al Ghul, as some people may say, or Ra's al Ghul, as others. And it's just got some great lines, man. And I've got a great impression of Batman. So there's this great part where he's cornered by Rachel, and she says, like, who are you? And he says, it's not who I am underneath, but what I do that defines me. And that is just, that just gets to me, man. It's such a good scene. And if you know Game of Thrones, the actor that plays Joffrey Baratheon was actually, he's playing this sweet little kid in this movie. And it's totally weird to see him because you can see Joffrey's face in him, but I don't think many people know that. Also, the direction of this film is very much naturalistic. It's not like too CGI'd up, although it does have more CGI than The Dark Knight, which is probably like, well, it's definitely, in my opinion, the greatest superhero movie ever, but one of the best movies of all time. I've seen it more times than anyone would want to admit. I've seen it probably like, I don't know, 40 times, 35, because I fell in love with it when I was a kid, and when I like something, I stick with it. And yeah, I've been watching it like religiously every single year. I watch it a few times. And it's got like the best pace of any movie you've seen, I'd say. It's one of those movies that just like flows really well. And it's got like, you know, one of the best villains ever, you know, minus maybe Darth Vader or something like that. Great direction, great acting, really compelling. It's got some like super sad scenes. And this movie is not as sad as Dark Knight, but it's got like a great arc for Bruce Wayne, who is, the premise of the movie is he wants revenge for his parents' death, which most people know that his parents are gunned down in an alleyway, and he blames himself for this, and he wants to do revenge on the person that killed his mother and father. However, he sort of grows from that, and he turns this desire for revenge into a desire for justice. And that's where he gets the Batman character, and he fights criminals, but he has a rule never to kill anybody, and it makes it more fun to watch, in my opinion. Even though I love action, and I love to see... Say, I sound like a crazy person, but I love to see, like, action and violence on screen. I think it's really fun. And, there is no death in this movie, but it's really good to watch because there's great, like, hand-to-hand combat scenes. But the character is my favorite, and I think Batman's definitely the best superhero. Just, you know, just most relatable. Alright, guys, but I'm gonna have to sign out early. I have an engagement, unfortunately, to go to. I did not expect, so we're gonna play some another pre-recorded show here. You're gonna get all the music you need. Unfortunately, my computer wasn't working today, so I had to use the one in the studio, and it doesn't have YouTube Premium, so that's why there were some gaps between the songs, because I didn't want to play the ads. And yeah, so thank you for watching. This is Nima Golbabai on KUCI 88.9 Irvine. I was subbing for Soul Sounds. Sorry for a little bit of an unconventional music choice I picked, but I don't know anything about K-pop, unfortunately, so I couldn't do that. But yeah, thank you for watching. This has been Nima. I'm on 4 to 5 on Wednesdays, talk about movies. I think maybe next week we're going to be talking about Donnie Darko, a movie that I have made a promise that I would watch, and I have to go watch it, and I think it's going to be great, as usual, and we're going to talk about that Wednesday from 4 to 5. But like I said, this is 11:11 today, so it's been a very cool day for me, and I hope it has been for you. And thank you, I'm with you to the end of the line. Gonna play some PSAs, sign out, and then play a pre-recorded show. Thank you.